Good afternoon. Mga kakwentuhan. Alam, ano?
Kaptunan sa
Afternoon, CC. How are you?
Afternoon, yes, I'm good.
Right. Are you in Manila or you are in Malaysia?
Currently in Malaysia, I'll be heading over mid of May.
Okay. So who's left in Manila?
Currently will be James and the rest of the engineer team.
Okay. Well, this is your first time, CC?
Yeah, it's my first time.
Okay. Better make it the best.
No worries, I'll try my best.
Did you not get the background?
No.
No?
Yeah, don't have.
I love
Let
the
me check.
background sent to you.
Let me check.
Len, asan na yung background natin, Len?
Send ko po sa inyo.
Send mo nga dito and then send mo rin kay CC. So, good afternoon sa ating mga kakwentuhan, no? Ang aking snappy na classmate sa Master Salasal. Mr. Carlos Sabit. Paps, musta ka na, Paps? Si sino pa tong iba? Ray. Si Ralph. Good afternoon, Mr. Ralph. Ah, yung ating Vice President sa NCR chapter, si Kuya George. Kuyang, musta ka na, Kuyang? And si Nico Navarrete is also watching. Christopher Ray Lungay. Good afternoon, Ray. Yang Zewi. Good afternoon. Where are you from, Mr. Yang Zewi? Sir Alan, good afternoon. Press Alan. Yung ating isang classmate pa sa LaSalle Masters, si Mr. Christopher Tops or si Pops Tops. Magandang hapon, bro. Si Coy Coleman, good afternoon. Juana de la Cruz, good afternoon. Good afternoon sa ating lahat. Len, wala pa rin yung ano natin, background. Si Darwin. Good afternoon, Mr. Timothy Quick, the big man. Good afternoon, brother. You're probably in Singapore, no? If I am not mistaken. And Shian Mark Domingo. Good afternoon. Where is our background?
Nasa chat na, Mr. Chair.
Saang chat na?
Dito po, Mr. Chair, sa chat box natin. I-send ko na lang din sa BOD.
Dito BOD, sige. Diyan mo sa BOD. Yun. Can you send to CC also? AC. Ano ba ngayon? Ad video. CC, did you get the background? Not yet. Len will send it to you.
Yep, downloading, but let me check.
Below the minimum allowed resolution. Ah, so I cannot use it. Okay, never mind. Okay, Mr. Silan, good afternoon. Mr. Ian Palatao, good afternoon. Ang ating executive director, si Arlene, is in Bacolod right now. Kasi ano sila, mayroon tayong outreach program doon, Pigs Pro Cares, no? So bigay sila ng lecture sa mga parents about the dangers of the internet, no? To women and children. And also the digital parenting that was course through us by the CWC. So we are doon sa tatlong natin mga ka-PIGS Pro, yung ating tatlong E, educate, elevate, and expand. So educate is PIGS Pro educates the community on the dangers of the internet to women and children. So we want to be able to contribute to the to bringing down the possible number of victims of phishing, scamming, and online sexual abuse of children, no? And exploitation of children. So diyan tayo sa educate focus. Last month we were in La Union, no? So we did our educating in La Union, the community, the high school students naman yung natin doon. Month before that, we were in Rizal. So hopefully we will be in more provinces to be able to teach the parents on how they can protect their children, no? And also the vulnerable sector. So on the other E is elevate. This is elevating the skills of cybersecurity professionals. So we want to have cybersecurity professionals more supply, no, of cybersecurity professionals. So dito naman ang focus natin dito is to provide trainings, certifications, and internships to graduating students or newly grad students that were endorsed and recommended by the chapters, by the different chapters. So if you have a chapter near you have kids or graduating or newly grads, then your chapter can endorse, no? It's a free training and certification program that's supposed to cost $2,000-$2,500. And then the expand, no? We want to expand the profession, the cybersecurity profession, and the cybersecurity market to the provinces. So that is why we go to the provinces. That's why we build and create and activate chapters. I believe nandito si SJG, no? He's from Aurora, Baler, Aurora, and they are about to create their own Pigs Pro chapter in Aurora, no? So we'll be there soon to activate and expand the cybersecurity profession and the cybersecurity market. So interesting. In the next few months, we will be launching the 10-month training program in producing a true blue cybersecurity professional. So again, this will be given for free. We prefer to give this to graduating students or newly grad students. All right, Mr. CC, oh, we already have our audience waiting for you to give them what you're supposed to give them. I give you the... Who will introduce Arlene? Will you introduce CC? Or will you introduce yourself, CC?
Yeah, I can. Sure, no problem. Let me take
okay.
over.
You have the floor.
All right. Okay. Sharing my screen now. All right. Thank you, everyone. It's an honor to be joining here together with everyone to go through about what we actually will be emerging into the cybersecurity world. So again, my name is CC. So later I'll be going through the details of doing a little bit intro of me. But the topic here we'll be actually discussing is what will be actually the future of the technology, unlocking opportunities as well as what are the challenges in the current cybersecurity world that we actually face, especially when it comes to the current generation of the new era where technology is actually growing very, very fast. So let's move on. So a little bit about myself. So my name is Chen Chun, you can call me CC. So actually I'm a pre-sales consultant and also doing solutioning for the company. So here a little bit of myself, of the professional certificate I have. I've gone through a few certificates like ISACA, ITIL, going through like one of the famous cloud provider, AWS, a few of the SIEM solution as well as on the cybersecurity certificate. So in all of my current industry, we actually gone through a few industry like telecommunication, finance sector, oil and gas, etc. So on my current existing career, we're actually focusing more into like the current SOC operation, cybersecurity operation center, doing threat hunting, incident response, as well as doing deployments. So all of this is actually part of it, and we actually have a few major projects that actually involve like a few healthcare in Malaysia and Singapore. One of the top three Japanese car manufacturers also actually engaged our services as well. Top telecommunications in Malaysia as well as Philippines and so on. Okay. So next, when we talk about cybersecurity, what is the one word that you actually thought in the mind? Any ideas? So it can be actually something good, something bad, depending on what you think of, but let me give you the answer here. The answer of when we talk about cybersecurity is on protection. Why is protection? It's because that when we talk about protection, it's actually covering a huge range of, a broad range of the things that we actually cover. For example, like the strategies, the technologies, as well as the practices. So all of these actually lead to a protection where it comes to involvement of people, process, and technology as well. So to let you understand more about that one word over here, what do you see in this picture? On the right side, you can both see it actually both is actually very dark, but the thing is, if you actually have a closer look at the right side, it's actually the galaxy of our universe. This is actually involved of all those stars, all those planets, and also the galaxy that, whether is it known or unknown. But on the left side, if you look closely, it's actually on the internet fabric, which currently how our technologies, our internet actually interconnects around the world. And if you can see on the internet fabric, the brightest or the brightest point is actually those companies that are actually generating the most information in the world, for example, like Google, Microsoft, and etc. So those are the known galaxy that we actually see. But what are those that other that we don't know, we don't see? In the galaxy, there's also good planet, bad planet, etc. as well. But in the internet fabric as well, we also see there's good actors, bad actors, which comes to those people like us to do protection, as well as those people that do attacks, especially those hackers. So these are the main criteria that we actually look into why that is actually a huge thing that is actually protection is very, very important. So the thing is, what is out there in the whole galaxy? We doesn't know whether is there any planets that actually having better technology than us. Same as well, in the cybersecurity world, we also don't know in a sense that from hacker point of view or threat actor point of view, do they actually have technology which is beyond us? And this is why it leads to cybersecurity is important, because for hackers and for threat actors, they only look into what they want to gain, in a sense that they want to just do attacks for funds, do attack to gain financial and so on. But as the protector or the guardian, we are actually protecting ourselves as in the only organization. For example, like a few groups is only protecting themselves, but we don't have a community to actually protect the whole environment, unless you're like Star Trek. So from here, it's actually a combination of multiple people that actually do research to actually go and understand in the galaxy, is there any threats that is actually threatening the planet? Same as well, if let's say in cybersecurity world, we actually have a community, a group of people to actually share the details and also to share the research output, which actually can protect the whole cybersecurity world. The reason why is, when you look into the current digital transformation here, currently, since technology is actually moving very fast and we actually go into a new era, we are looking into Industry 4.0. When we talk about Industry 4.0, everything is actually interconnected, as in whatever you do daily is actually automated, whatever you do in a daily sense. Now, as in mobile phone is very, very common to everyone, including laptops, IoT, and so on. So whatever things that you actually see in real life is actually related to technologies. It's actually related to digital. That's why all of the digital information is actually really critical for us. In comparing to the traditional industry, like 1.0, 2.0, so they only do focus on those that is actually not digitalized. As you can see nowadays, most of the shoppings you can actually done online. Through a phone, by a single click, you can get whatever things you want. So this is the transformation of the current digital world. And if you can see here, based on the statistic, comparing the individual that is actually accessing to the internet is actually 5.3 billion, which is 66% of the population. So all of this data is actually captured from last year, 2023. So you can actually see that it's actually more than 50% of all of the coverages, be it from the user subscriber from the phones, the population that actually using internet, the social media user identities, it's actually more than 62% as well. And if you look into the individual in the Philippines that actually use internet, it's actually more than 86 million, which is a total of 73% out of the whole population. So with this amount of data, I can actually link to the next slide here. So basically, this is the data that actually being generated every minute in the world. Be it come from, you can see here, there's also people shopping online. In every 60 seconds, there's 6 million of people shopping online, 6.3 million of Google search as well. So over here, the highest data they can actually see is actually coming from Snapchat, a total of 3.5 billion of Snapchat being created just within 60 seconds. So this data is actually generated this year, which is very, very latest. But if you calculate all this amount of data that actually surface in the area, in the whole internet, with this amount of data being generated every minute, is actually equivalent to the higher amount of attack surface that the attacker can actually gain access, or maybe you'll be being the chance of being attacked by the attackers. But before going there, let me ask a question. Have you really experienced a virus attack or malware or cyber attacks? So there's a lot of scenario that maybe you have experienced, as in your mobile devices or your desktop become very, very slow, or maybe that there's a malware being detected in your laptop, as in sometimes your laptop suddenly reboot. But there's also cases that do you really know that you're being attacked? Maybe that you are being attacked, but you doesn't know that there is an attack happening to you. So this attack, this kind of attack, not just only focusing on those virus, those malwares, and so on, but it's also include like, do you receive a spam call? Do you receive spoofing emails, phishing emails? So those are the things that actually consist of whether do you actually experience that, which leads to, are we really prepared ourselves to actually take up the challenges as in when there is a coming? And is there any opportunity that is actually for us to leveraging on those challenges to protect the community? Because like we mentioned, nowadays, most of the detection, most of us is actually very used to technologies. Everyone will have a phone, and maybe that you have more than that. Maybe you have a tablet, maybe you have a laptop. And nowadays, with smart home, you have more things that is actually being connected to the internet. So we are actually enlarging our attack surface. We are actually exposing whatever things that is actually possible to make us vulnerable. Because if you see at the current working environment, when the pandemic actually strike during 2020, most of the organization, especially financial company, they actually cannot sustain because they are not prepared as in. Their environment is actually required to be working from office. They don't have any hybrid or they don't have any remote workspace. But when since the pandemic came over, then actually we required to adapt the culture to go for remote or hybrid workplace. This actually will actually reduce the security portion of the company. But it doesn't mean that hybrid working is not good, because if you see here at the right side, working remotely can actually improve the productivity, can actually reduce the cost of operation, can actually attract more talents, because nowadays most of the talents will be, or not most of the people will actually request for working from home because of flexibility. And it's also prioritizing the employee because they actually have more freedom as in doing more things and so on. But during the pandemic, even though in cybersecurity world, we are actually blessed that we are actually the frontliner, as in we are the frontliner for cybersecurity world. We are actually helping customers to actually protect their network environment. Even though in the pandemic, attackers won't be sleeping. Attackers will actually attack no matter what time, anywhere, anytime. So we are actually blessed that we are actually the frontliner when we are actually able to continue working as usual. So with this said, the thing is, with the hybrid working, the security portion of the remote space is actually very, very less compared to a corporate network. For example, like if you're working in a home and comparing you're working in a corporate office will have more full scale of perimeter, security perimeter, as in they have their own firewalls, they have their own WAF, IPS, IDS, they have multiple perimeter and policy to actually cover to protect their employee. But this kind of parameters won't be appearing from your home or from the coffee shop that you actually went, be it from the Starbucks or any other coffee shop. So this actually led attackers to have the opportunity to attack the remote workers. And this doesn't only apply to cybersecurity industry. If you can see on here, the financial service at the left side here is actually the most prepared for cybersecurity because they have the luxury to gain security parameters and so on. But if you can see here, the most that being attacked is actually on the aerospace and also the defense. The most that being compromised is actually coming from the government and hospitality and, industry. And the most vulnerable is actually coming from transportation and logistics. So all this industry is actually being affected, as in regardless, the attacker don't look into what industry you are, they would like to attack whenever they want and wherever they want. So these are the few examples of what is actually happening around the world. So previously, there's the cases of the field health being compromised, and it's actually caused a data breach. At the end, it's caused around 13 to 20 million of members being affected, as well as a few more cases, especially on the ransomware attacks in Philippines, is actually doubled comparing to the statistic of 2023. But now we are not just talking about the targeted attack towards the industry, because with the combination of the technology, there's something called AI. So it's now, instead of being a targeted attack, it's actually an intelligent attack with the help of AI. And you can see here, based on the trending, by adopting the AI to actually perform cyber criminal, is actually slowly increasing since 2022. And you can see here from the statistic from 2024, it's actually growing very, very dramatically. So in the future, with the help of AI, it's actually beneficial the not just the people that make use of it, but also on the attacker itself. By looking into this cyber kill chain, most of the attack that actually happening on the past years is actually from months, from days up until 2 months. But with the help of AI, we can actually reduce up to minutes. All of this action, reconnaissance, weaponization, deliverable, up until the action on the objective, as in doing some extraction of the file, exfiltration, planting a malware, planting a ransomware, all this can be happened within minutes of time. So with this, are we really prepared for the fight? Are we really being prepared, as in when there's a real attack happening, as in now, is the company or is the organization able to protect themselves, avoid this kind of fight? So next question is, why should you also join us as in the cybersecurity world to protect the community? Because based on statistics as well, we are looking into the shortage of cybersecurity staff. If you can see here, educational is actually the highest, with a total of 78% shortage in cybersecurity related industries, job scope, government, military, and also non-profit. So all these statistics is actually showing that how urge of the world is actually requiring a cybersecurity personnel or a talent. So a few more news as well. From the Philippines, actually face a lot of shortage, it's actually around the world. Not just Philippines, it's also around the world, but this is the truth. By looking into that, the cybersecurity market is actually very huge. Not just only to focus on what are the things that we should be focusing on. So if you can see here on the key trending, attacks are actually growing very, very fast. And with all these kind of technologies that are actually happening around the world, it's actually very crucial to have more talented people around the world. But what can you do? Cybersecurity is very huge. So by just Googling some cybersecurity job, you can actually see there's a lot of job scopes available, from the range of looking into security analysts, administrator, engineers, auditor as well. So these are the available job scope is actually around the world, but looking into the details of how to go next, how to succeed in the cybersecurity field, we have more to go. For example, if you can see here, there's a lot, as in from the cybersecurity job scope, it can actually spread up to application engineer, threat analyst, vulnerable, and so on. But looking into here, the right side of here, so it's actually putting a remark that it's actually very less competition, starting at a very, very higher salary, and also easy to become expert, because all of these governance risk and risk assessment is more focusing on readings and also compliance, which is more towards theoretically. And the rest of the team, the rest of the job scope is more towards practical on how to actually master on the particular scope. So not just that, if you can see on this pyramid going up, as long as you are actually able to cope and also to actually understand the trending of the technology, learn across the trend, we can actually go very, very fast. As in 3 years' time, we can actually go up to security architecture and so on. And with more effort to put in, you can be someone in the senior management, not just looking into whatever role that is possible, but there's also a few range to choose of, starting from technology, governance, risk, or compliance. But nevertheless, starting starting point will be actually a point that you actually need to go ahead. So there will be a few courses available. So these are the courses that is actually related to cybersecurity. Of course, official courses will be all those professional courses that you need to attend and so on. However, there's also free online courses that is actually available through the market to actually kickstart on your cybersecurity path. And last but not least, these are the reasons that you should be actually pursuing on the security field. With the demanding growth of the technology, of course, as well, there will be demanding growth of opportunity. And with that opportunity coming into picture, you'll be having more various job scope is actually available. As in, if you're interested into the hands-on technical side, you can go for engineer. While if let's say you're more towards compliance side, you can actually go for GRC, compliant risk auditor, and so on. And come with the continuous improvement of the technology, we as cybersecurity field or as an IT field, we actually require to be considered learning on what to adapt, what is the latest trending, and so on, and to stay ourselves updated to the latest trending. And of course, as well, more the interesting part is on the salary. Definitely, with the demanding of the needs of the talents, definitely salary will be part of the main thing that will be actually very, very attractive to all of the new talents and also capable person. So, last but not least, choose a job you love. And if you're enjoying your work, you won't be feeling stressful and so on. Okay, may the force be with you. Thank you. Any questions?
Thank you, CC.
All right, sir.
In cyber, we don't say may the force be with you. We say may the packets be with you.
May the warriors be with you.
In Star Wars, they say may the force be with you. All right. You may now remove your presentation, CC. Okay. Turn on your camera so people can see you.
Sure.
All right. So very interesting. We've been saying over and over again that the cybersecurity ecosystem, in terms of career and job, is very wide. So,
Sir.
not to mention the sales part. No? We also need good and learned cybersecurity professional who can sell intelligently and who can sell objectively. No longer the traditional selling that was used to be done on IT and network side. So in this case, especially today, we have seen a growing huge amount of growth, no? When it comes to cyber attacks
Yes,
and
definitely.
victimizing micro, small, medium, and large enterprises. Even home users are being victimized. So the career is growing. The profession is growing, but we are not producing enough cybersecurity professionals. That's always been the problem. And going back to what I said earlier, in one of the letter E, the letter E's that we aspire is that we expand and we elevate the skills. That's why we welcome and we try to ask more and more students to, you know, come and join the cybersecurity profession. We don't have questions here. No. Maybe CC in Malaysia. How is the cybersecurity profession in Malaysia? Are you guys seeing increase of in number in terms of new grads or graduating or newly grads students venturing into cybersecurity?
In Malaysia, it's still very, very shortage of cybersecurity professional, but as well, same as well, that it's actually having more demands from the corporate side that actually required to hire more talents.
So what coming from the academe, is there a robust program from the academe?
As of now, I believe that it's still in progress to discuss of what are the program that will be held, but I think that coming from field career fair is actually having more and more job opportunities available, be it coming from the IT or be it coming from cybersecurity as well. Because looking into the current trending of the university here is actually offering more towards cybersecurity path as well.
Because in the Philippines, we have universities also. We have schools offering cybersecurity, but we have not
Yes.
the impact yet in terms of creating more cybersecurity professionals. We have a question here, Mr. Rai Rai Dimapilis. So, part of the culture of Filipinos is to post their life updates in Facebook. What is your advice for them? Do you have a Facebook, Sisi?
Ready use.
Okay, so maybe this is one of your
I
work.
think.
Go ahead.
Yep, but I think that using Facebook or using any social media. Okay, sorry. I think that using Facebook or using social media is actually very, very common around the world, as in the current era. But looking into one of the concerns that previously personal experience, as in by posting in that where is your location, because nowadays people like to actually take pictures and also do a pinpoint of where are you, especially when you go out for vacation. So with that action being taken, there's one time in my past experience that I went for a holiday and then actually do a pin saying that I was out of home, I'm traveling, not at home, and so on. But at the end, it comes to a personal threat, as in there's a theft actually broke into the house. So with this kind of, even though it's actually not related to cybersecurity, but as in the use of the social media nowadays, it's actually not only limited to the personal, it can actually affect a lot of other things because you're exposing your data to the public.
Yes, I remember a friend also had the same incident. No, they were going, whole family is going out to another city for a vacation, posted on Facebook, and their house was ransacked because nobody is home, and you just gave the information. Before, we don't tell anyone that we are leaving the house empty, right? But today, everyone is almost everyone. Sorry, Rai Rai is a she, Miss Rai Rai. Sorry. Okay. Now another question from Miss Buhay OFW, Jaynard Vlog. Still good to enroll a cybersecurity engineer course for 2 years right now, or no need? Just take a training is enough. What can you say, CC? How was
I
your
think this may
cybersecurity
depends.
training?
For me personally, I'm coming from a background of going through university of start focusing on IT and also cybersecurity. But as in the current stage, there's also a lot of provider also providing a lot of training courses as well. So I think it may depends on what is the objective that is actually required. As in, if let's say that going for training courses is enough, it should be over. We can also go for that route. Or if you like to actually have the university style, as in going through courses, it will be also very, very useful.
Well, if I may add, because I never had a formal cybersecurity education, no? I finished Bachelor of Science in Electrical Engineering, took the board exam, but never practiced. It depends on which part of cybersecurity you want to be, no? Because there's the governance part, the risk, operations, audit, and compliance. No, however, I always say that cybersecurity is not a full course. It is a specialized course, but you need the foundations. And what are the foundations? You need to know network. You need to know systems administration. You need to know database. You need to know programming or a little bit of programming. In my time, I learned scripting. No, I started with Perl, no Bash, and then Perl, and then Python came, and Ruby Rails came. So all these things we need to learn as a foundation. No, but I also believe that you don't need 4 years to sit in a classroom to learn all this. You only need maybe, you're right, no, maybe 2 years or maybe 1 year. Depends. If you are really, in my case, I learned the foundations in 3 to 4 months because I was really learning. I wasn't doing anything else, so I learned a lot, and I didn't want to practice my degree because computer was booming, internet started in 1994, so I wanted to be in that space. So it depends on you, and depends also on what you want to do. Governance, you don't really need to be very technical, right? If you are in operations, then you need to know which technical part of the operations. So depends, no? Depends. But still, I think one of the necessary ingredients to become a cybersecurity professional is your being analytical. You need to be analytical and paranoid, of course. Okay. We have another question. So in the curriculum of the cybersecurity program is not yet geared towards cybersecurity that is in general assessment. I don't understand. Maybe Fernando, you can clarify. Are you asking or are you saying? Although I agree. Tops, Christopher. So thank you, CC. I think awareness and education is the key to be cultivated from the start of the curriculum. Agree. Like what we advocate here in PixPro, what we also need here are professionals to also be part of the academy to teach not just newly graduates, but also have the foundational discipline introduced to kids and teams. Well, fully agree. No, what we have seen, what I personally saw, is that we have teachers who are not well experienced in the actual world. So the problem with cybersecurity is it cannot be manualized. It is not manualized, right? So risk, yes, it's manualized. Governance, yes, it's manualized. That's why if you notice, there's a lot of professionals who are into risk. Because you can read about it and then you can do the job. Audit is also manualized, no? But when it comes to the operations part, this is where manual thing is non-existent. For example, Security Operations Center. I think every company has its own definition of a Security Operations Center. Best practice in cybersecurity. If you search Google, you'll find different best practices. There's 3 best practices, 5, 10, etc. So it's non-manualized, no? So that's why you also need someone who is well-versed in the industry to teach the students. Okay. There's few colleges, universities that offer in cybersecurity courses as a core course. Yes, very few. I think 3 or 4 maximum, maybe. But I think the question I always ask is, who created the curriculum? What was the background in terms of experience of those who created the curriculum? And then, okay, I myself in the college doesn't get the support when it comes to cybersecurity. Oh, that's sad. Well, we all have that kind of experience. And it's okay. So Anthony Koo said, and the passion and the passionate as well as the consistency of continuous learning. Cybersecurity landscape is changing every day. What can you say, CC?
Yeah, definitely, definitely. It's changed with the enhancement or also the evolution of the technology. Definitely, the cyber threat landscape is actually moving fast ahead. So that's why we actually need more professional and more talents to actually learn about the trend and also be prepared before the attack actually come in. As well as looking into the current cybersecurity opportunity as in the education, be it from the education or job wise. I think as of now, a lot of the academy or the university is actually looking very, very concerned. That's why as of now, they're actually slowly introducing more cybersecurity related courses and curriculums so that people are actually aware of this trending to adapt on it, as well as getting more job opportunities, be it coming from what kind of angle, like Sir Angel mentioned, from the technical side or coming from the risk and compliance side.
Okay, Mr. Zeno, what is the average salary of cybersecurity? It varies, no? It depends on the company. I mean,
yes.
There are companies giving out two times, three times the other what the other companies are giving.
Yes.
So, I think that's where the the reason why the resignations are very or moving to other companies are very lucrative because you know when you are already 1 year or 2 years experience, especially in a security operations center, then other companies will hire you for times two, times three, even times four of your current salary. But you know that is a risk that we have to accept. That's why we need to create more and produce more cybersecurity professionals coming from the schools, so that we don't have to consider that as a risk. No, yeah, hire them, but we can hire more anyway. So should we offer ethical hacking as part of the curriculum, part of the CUI? Well, first, there's nothing ethical about hacking. I think many years ago, that's been changed already. No, it's already penetration testing. No.
Yes.
No
hacking
longer
is definitely is not ethical. We call it penetration testing.
Yeah. So penetration testing, definitely you teach it. But to me, it has to be under the umbrella of cyber defense. Because
yes,
what
correct.
I've seen is that we've been teaching penetration testing for training here, training there. But you know, the truth is, we are not able to get our ROI for people who were trained to do penetration testing. Because you don't do penetration testing every day, but you do cyber defense every day, 24/7. So you focus the discipline into building, having someone who can create a resilient cybersecurity practice. No, ethical hacking, penetration testing. I think half of my career I was offering that service, but I saw no value after. That's why I stopped. So let's focus on cyber defense. And Mr. Jimbo, magandang hapon. So I think the reason, according to Torres Jean, I think the reason for the lack of cybersecurity professionals here in the Philippines is due to the shortage of homegrown organizations which provide cybersecurity services. So no wonder that even our government agencies are prone to outside attacks. What I would like to see in the future is for the integration of risk management, cybersecurity, information security into one college course. That's something that we fully agree. Hopefully, we can really have that kind of course, you know, so that when the student graduates, you produce a true blue cyber warrior who can hit the ground running when he apply or he or she applies. Okay, Miss Rai Rai, here in UAE, I teach cybersecurity courses in an applied approach. I hope I can share my knowledge. Hey, we'll take note of that, Miss Rai Rai. Can our executive director, I think, is online in Facebook. Edi Arlene, can you get in touch with Miss Rai Rai so she can share to us her her skills? So definitely, we'll get in touch with you, Miss Rai Rai. And then Tops, if only possible, I can design a full course on cybersecurity. We can have it as a separate streamlined course where at the end, the student can choose a specialization for 1 year only. Yes, agree, agree. Kojin. So, Code Raja. In our office, cybersecurity is planned by top management to be headed by our physical security department without knowledge of any foundation. Well, that's a little bit sad. Maybe we should start including the security guards in cybersecurity trainings. Which vendor certification are you recommending? Well, it depends, no? Which part do you want to venture in cybersecurity? If you want to go into the perimeter defense, then any of the firewall or IPS or web application firewalls you can take. If you want to venture into the security operation center part, wherein the incident response is incident response, incident investigation, and threat intelligence and threat hunting is the focus, then there's also another other vendors. Okay. All right. So Ms. Rai is a very good speaker. Okay, zero trust, according to Mr. Anthony Koo. Zero trust is one part of the mitigation strategy in combating the hack threats. Today, we are looking into defense in depth by having multi-layer defense to strengthen our or harden the capability of response against bad perpetrators. Hacker will never rest. And cybersecurity will never end. Oh, I like that, huh? So if hackers never rest, then the cybersecurity professionals or the cyber defendants, the defenders shouldn't rest as well. Right? That's why we don't have weekends. So if you want to be in the cybersecurity profession, but you love your weekends, you advocate for work-life balance, then this is not the profession for you. And because if you, especially CC understands very well how it is in the operation side, right, CC?
Yeah, definitely.
So zero trust, there's also zero rest. If there's zero trust, there's also zero rest. We don't rest because our enemies don't rest as well. Okay, how do we make security and cybersecurity go down to the common people as in general masses? Well, unfortunately, that would be very difficult to do because as we mentioned earlier, this is not something that we can manualize and cascade it to the masses, no? So we will have to devise something that those who are in the ISP, the telcos, the content providers, or the service providers will have to do something to improve cybersecurity in an inclusive perspective. Include everyone, no? not just us. Because resiliency, for example, will never work if you are the only one who's practicing resiliency. What about your suppliers? What about your customers? What about your partners? Right? Okay, si Colonel Agustin Matib. Drawing from the talk of Sir Angel that other components of CyberSec can be manualized while other components cannot. Therefore, cybersecurity is both science and art. Amen. Aside from knowledge, we also have to be creative. That's perfectly said, no? It's science and art. It's creativity. You need to be imaginative. For you to be able to conceptualize your cyber defense, you need to be very creative. You need to be very imaginative. And not only that, you need to be very adaptive because it's a highly dynamic environment. You cannot design your defense today and then revisit that next year. No, cannot do that. Because you have external dependencies, and we call them threat actors. No, so you keep on breaking your brains to how to make your defenses adapt to the new terrains. No, unfortunately, there are a lot of dependencies like budget, executive support, other groups who need to move also for you to be able to deploy and implement. And that's where we, most of the time, if you agree, CC, that's where we get hit, you know, when we cannot implement right away because this group is not ready, that group is not ready, there is no budget, and there is no support from the executive. Others are thinking differently for all these things. Next. So health, life balance lang, Mr. Chair. Health is a cybersecurity issue. Correct. That's why you need to be healthy. So you don't get stressed. So use AI to defend against AI. How can we securely integrate Gen AI in a corporate environment? Well, unfortunately, there's no... until today, I think, CC, if you can comment that, for me, I haven't seen a Gen AI that's been perfectly created to defend us from cyber attacks. In fact, the AI that the threat actors are using are even better than the AIs that we are using.
Yeah, it could be that way. Correct.
Unfortunately, what I've seen one AI who can, you just say, this is my target. This is the OS, this is the version, this is the application. Then the AI will generate you an exploit. And all you need to think of is how to deliver that exploit. You either use phishing, you either use social engineering or other means of social engineering, all these things. The exploit will work already. Right?
True, so, true, true.
We need to wait for that AI that can save us from the bad AI, no? So the good AI, the bad AI, hopefully the good AI will be much better. Defense in depth, yes. So what do you think are the reasons, factors that contributed to the avalanches of cybersecurity attacks in the Philippines government sectors? Mr. Fernando, it's difficult to guess. No, we don't know, but I think we can speculate that data is very expensive. It's being traded. There are a lot of groups who are buying data. That's why there are also those who are stealing data. If no one is buying, no one is going to steal, right? So why are there no perfect security? Even firewall, VPN are prone to attacks. Well, that's because to me, I don't know, CC, if you will agree, that's because the threat actors are more dynamic compared to the defenders. You buy a firewall today, when will you change your firewall? 5 years after? 10 years after? Yeah, you buy a solution, a cybersecurity solution today. When will you replace it? If you go to your if you ask for money to replace your 3-year-old firewall, I don't think it's gonna happen.
True, right? True. Agree with it. It's like building a house, and then how frequent that you'll be actually changing the door of the house.
Yes, exactly. Right, and the threat actors are doing nothing but studying how to circumvent, how to break, how to brute force all these security measures. Right? Even VPN. VPN is already dead. Others don't understand. SIEM, like IBM Q-Radar, use security intelligent algorithm. Well, I'm not a fan of Q-Radar. help to spread human firewall. Yes, this is something that we really need to do. We need to help to spread the human firewall, because that's the only way. Humans, if we become the security countermeasure ourselves, then that might help drop to the minimum the possibility of a compromise. Okay, next-gen firewall and other security solutions will become obsolete when the quantum era arrives. Are they not obsolete yet, Sisi?
Sorry?
The next-gen firewalls, are they not obsolete yet?
I think next-gen firewall is currently adapting everywhere. It's just that, how soon?
Yeah, that's if you're going to analyze, because I've been here since the first, I was already here since the first website hacking happened. If I go back to that year and analyze every year how the threat actors became better every year, then better every month, better every week. Compare that to the defenders. How many times do we get trainings? Right? Can you sit every day in a training? No, because we have a job to do. Can you sit at least every week in an updated training? No, because we have a job to do. So there is a discrepancy. The threat actors are getting better, the defenders are not. Or the threat actors are getting better faster, much faster than the defenders. And that is a real problem. How can we stop social engineering attacks? I don't think we can stop social engineering attacks. Not this year, maybe not next year. Algorithm that we are still using, the threat models that will be obsolete, especially in the use of Gen AI. So we need to develop data for defense that we ourselves should sustain and keep up with the data of the attackers. Agree. So is crypto tight? L1 secured? I don't understand. Well, I think, as we mentioned from the start, that cybersecurity is wide in terms of ecosystem. And therefore, our attack entry points are also wide in terms of number. And if you cannot cover all the attack entry points, and you cannot improve your defenses in every attack entry point, and you cannot respond to every successful attack that's happening within your ecosystem, then you will really have a problem. And if we are going to consider the counterpart of that ecosystem, the people that you need, the process that you need to deploy, the technology that you need to buy, and the intelligence that you need to gather 24/7, if that is not at par with your ecosystem, your attack entry points, and the growing sophistication of the threat actors, then the resiliency that we are aspiring for will continue to be a thing that we will keep on aspiring. We'll never be able to achieve that. We have to change our mindset, because Even when I said that VPN is dead, a lot of negative reactions. Without even thinking why. Without even trying to process why is VPN dead. VPN was created when we were still using desktops. When our users are not freely bringing their devices outside and connecting to unsecure networks, downloading and installing unsecure software. Today, if you have a VPN user whose laptop is compromised, and then that user connected to your internal network through VPN, it's not only the laptop of the user that's become part of your network, also the attacker, also the threat actor. You brought him inside your house instead of just keeping him outside, right? That's the reason why. Oh, you say you have EDR? How many EDRs have been compromised already and bypassed? You have VPN? You have firewall? You have IPS? All these things are attackable. What can you say?
Yeah, I think that for this, totally agree. No matter how well the environment is actually being secured, how many attacks they can actually prevent, one single attempt of successful attacks can actually bring a lot of impact towards from the corporate point of view or whatsoever. So as long as one single attempt is success, and I think it's all that.
Exactly, and if you are talking about VPN, it means, you know, before the concept was so that you become part of my security, I will make you part of my network. So I will give you a virtual private network. Okay. But today that devices of users are being compromised and attacked, every time you include a remote device as part of your internal network, then you also brought in the threat actor to your network. And it's just a matter of probing and enumerating assets, and voila, you have a ransomware in your domain. Right? Okay, so I think we are already at past six. Again, thank you very much for our mga Kapiks Pro, ating kakwentuhan for today. No, we'll have CC's parting words for everyone. CC, what can you say?
I think that as of the current cybersecurity trend, yeah, it's definitely very, very hard to actually being introduced and towards the ground. But I think what we're actually trying to do is actually do our best to expand the knowledge, to actually transfer the knowledge to those fresh grads, to those new talents, and let them become the new warriors that is actually available for the market to actually help the community to protect the cybersecurity world.
Amen. No, I couldn't agree more. As for me, I continue to advocate to educate the community. In PixPro, we elevate the skills of cybersecurity professionals and expand the profession to the provinces and to other places. No? And on top of that, I will continue to give thought-provoking ideas, even if a lot of naysayers or bashers are reacting. No? But if no one is going to think differently, if no one is going to think in a dynamic perspective, we will never survive. One day, the hackers, the threat actors will own everything we have in our digital space or in our cyberspace. And we will be in peril and in chaos. With that, another exciting 1 hour kwentuhang cybersecurity with everyone. Today is Friday. As they say, happy weekend starts today, starts tonight. But for cybersecurity professionals and for the Philippine Institute of Cybersecurity Professionals, happy lang kami, walang weekend. Thank you, everyone. Sisi, thank you. And thank you for your time. Hopefully, we can have you again for
No
a
problem, sir. All right.
More technical
Sure.
session.
Sure. Selamat po.
Salamat. Salamat.
All right. Thank you.